Hey, Vsauce, Michael here. Earlier this month, I traveled to Kourou in French Guiana with Euronews to watch the launch of a Vega rocket. If it happened while I was there. Waiting at the observation point with only minutes to go, the launch was postponed because of weather. Even though the rocket scientists were using Comic Sans, the rocket didn't take off until the day after I had to be back in London. But it made me think, we can send satellites into orbit and people to the moon and predict solar eclipses thousands of years into the future, but yet we cannot reliably predict which way the wind will be blowing in the next hour or so. How can such monumental cosmic movements, light minutes or light years away from us, be understood, whereas the weather, which happens in the very same layer of the atmosphere we live in every day, remains such a mystery? Well, it has to do with the limits of what we know and what we can know. Planetary positions and terrestrial weather in the future are determined by their initial conditions. But over a short timescale, predicting the future position of a planet involves fewer variables than the weather. In order to accurately predict the weather, you need to know the complete and exact conditions of every molecule of air on Earth, how those molecules will interact with each other and the Earth, and how they will feed back and influence themselves by changing other molecules. This makes it incredibly difficult to predict the weather more than a week in advance. And this problem isn't going to go away. It is fundamental to our relationship with the universe. Given enough time, small, unnoticeable, unmeasurable, unknowable factors get magnified again and again, slowly, until eventually their impact is vastly significant and our predictions today are hopeless. Neil deGrasse Tyson mentions this in his brilliant Death by Black Hole, where he points out that the recoil from the launch of a single space probe can influence our future in such a way that in about 200 million years, the position of Earth in its orbit around the Sun will be shifted by nearly 60 degrees. Edward Lorenz gave this phenomenon its popular name. Predictability. Does the flap of a butterfly's wings in Brazil set off a tornado in Texas? The butterfly effect. A small change, like a butterfly deciding to flap its wings, can lead to a whole chain of events where bigger and bigger processes change just enough to lead to even more significant changes until finally an entire storm occurs somewhere different or not at all. The discipline that such thinking kickstarted is known as chaos theory. When the present determines the future, but the approximate present does not approximately determine the future. To us, the universe is full of if, but all things considered, we are pretty good at predicting the future and preparing for it. But some things are or were prepared for a future that hasn't occurred yet, or never did. And knowing more about those things sheds amazing perspective on the limits of our knowledge. Speaking of limits, let's begin with your life. Carpe diem. An online tool that, when given your birth date, uses the latest life expectancy data to give you back a grid of squares. One square represents 1 week, 7 days. The lighter ones are the weeks that you have already been alive. The darker ones are what you have left. Check sleep to see how many of your previous and future weeks will be spent sleeping. Of course, it's just an approximation. It's difficult to know if you will have more or fewer weeks to come. It's hard to know when it will all end. It's even more difficult to document, unless you are Reynaldo Dagsa, a councilman from the Philippines who took this photo of his family on New Year's Day, at the very same second that he was assassinated. The photo was later used to catch the killer. We can't predict everything, but in the event of an anticipated catastrophic event, severe weather, an incoming nuclear attack or asteroid, how would we all know what was going on? Well, many countries have systems in place to allow them to speak to as many people as quickly as possible. The United States has the Emergency Alert System. When triggered, the system interrupts all programming on radio and television with messages generated using text-to-speech automated voices. The warning tones are known, so what's kind of scary is that today we can take a peek and see what it would look like and what it would sound like if a catastrophic event occurred. In this example, a nuclear attack that threatened life across the entire country. First of all, you would likely hear sirens. And then, as you went to tune in to, say, TV, this is what you would hear and see.
We interrupt our programming. This is a national emergency. The following message is transmitted at the request of the United States government. This is not a test. A nuclear attack is occurring against the United States. 4 nuclear missiles have been launched from unknown locations and are expected to strike the United States within the next 15 minutes. Due to the uncertain tracks of these missiles, all residents of the United States should seek out and prepare to take shelter immediately.
Stand by for a message from the President of the United States.
If a catastrophic event occurred of global proportions, what would humanity do next? Well, there might be survivors. People hidden away in fortresses that we have built, like the North American Aerospace Defense Command, NORAD. Built into solid granite, shielded by steel plating to protect computer systems from electromagnetic pulses, and supported on springs so as to safely sway in the event of an earthquake, NORAD can protect humans and equipment from a 30 megaton nuclear blast just a mile away. After the event, it's places like this that would literally be humanity's last best chance of continuing life. The Svalbard Global Seed Vault is on the Norwegian island of Spitsbergen. Buried 390 feet inside a mountain, it safely stores and protects 250 million individual seeds for growing plants and crops if their vulnerable living relatives on the surface are all destroyed. Soviet technology existed to put people on the moon. Of course, they never did. If Russia had sent men to the moon, they would have walked around on it looking like this. The Khrushchev 94 was designed in 1967, but never used for Soviet manned lunar excursion. Russia did, however, send the first man into space and the first woman into outer space. They also sent the first dog into orbit around Earth. Unfortunately, the dog died soon after launch due to overheating, but later they sent Belka and Strelka, dogs on a rocket full of living organisms that became the very first to orbit the Earth and return to Earth alive. You can still see them today. The Moscow Cosmonautics Memorial Museum has the two dogs preserved, stuffed and on display as physical relics of Earthlings growing up and leaving their planet. I was also lucky enough to visit a restaurant in Moscow with menus, yep, that used Comic Sans. Oh, and I ate a star dog, which in the Cyrillic alphabet looks like it's called Crapdosis. The United States, of course, did send people to the moon, but recently we have learned that NASA, at the time, didn't know with the same certainty as other variables whether the first men on the moon would be able to leave. Just 2 days before humanity's historic moon landing, William Safire was asked to prepare a speech for President Nixon to read on television to the world if Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong became stranded on the moon. 30 years later, William Safire explained that Aldrin and Armstrong were supposed to reunite with the command module orbiting the moon.
But if they couldn't, and it was a good risk that they couldn't, then they would have to be abandoned on the moon, left to die there. And mission control would then have to use their euphemism, close down communication. And the men would have to either starve to death or commit suicide. And so we prepared for that with a speech that I wrote. And the president was ready to give that.
Luckily, Nixon never had to deliver the moon disaster speech. But to read it today, thinking of those two guys still alive on the surface of the moon, knowing that they will never get back to Earth, is chilling. Included in that speech were these lines. Fate has ordained that the men who went to the moon to explore in peace will stay on the moon to rest in peace. These brave men, Neil Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin, know that there is no hope for their recovery, but they also know that there is hope for mankind in their sacrifice. In ancient days, men looked at the stars and saw their heroes in the constellations. In modern times, we do much the same, but our heroes are epic men of flesh and blood. For every human being who looks up at the moon in the nights to come will know that there is some corner of another world that is forever mankind. And that's what I took away most from my trip to Kourou. Space isn't just a place for zero-G tricks or imagining sci-fi technology. Space is ever expanding and full of corners of other worlds that could one day become mankind's, if we choose to. And that doesn't minimize Earth. The Vega rocket I went to see sent up satellites designed to test electric solar wind sails for interplanetary travel, as well as satellites built to analyze the health of Earth's vegetation or to predict natural disasters. Just as our bodies benefit from having doctors and instruments beyond them that can probe, investigate, and diagnose, so does the Earth. Launch pads like the one in Kourou I got to visit are really just hospital waiting rooms for Earth, a place where our planet can wait for researchers and scientists to put their tools, their instruments, into use, into orbit. We may never know if something will or will not happen, but by pursuing space, corners of other worlds, we gain a perspective that can help us shrink the size of that mysterious and often frightening if. And as always, thanks for watching.